days of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Do this. Throw your hands up. Father, thank you so much. Thank you so much for your word. Thank you so much for your life. Thank you for the great exchange that you've given us, your life. You took our sin and gave us your righteousness. You took all of our sickness and gave us your health. You took our poverty and gave us your wealth. Thank you for the great exchange at the cross, that you died young so we could live a long, prosperous life, that you died single so we could be married and have a family. Thank you so much for loving us. And today, give us revelation. Open our eyes and our hearts to receive your word and to see the great life that you have in store for us. Thank you, Lord, for not being mad at us, but being madly in love with us. We thank you for it today. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. If you got your Bible today, we're going to continue on this series called Success God's Way. And we've been, over the last couple of weeks, we've been talking about work. Y'all, I don't know if you notice it. In whatever city you're in, you can probably pull up. And of course, we're in COVID-19 now, so these are unique times. And I know that many people are displaced from the work. Many people have been furloughed. Many people are out of work. But, you know, also, there are many people, when COVID-19 wasn't here, that just don't work. And so we've been looking at work from a biblical perspective. You know, that's, as believers, that's what we've got to do. We've got to get a mindset for viewing things God's way. We're kingdom citizens. And believe it or not, God has a higher life for us. We as believers have an unfair advantage in life because we've got the favor of God. And really, that was my first key. As we talked about the success God's way, the first and most important key is this, and that's relationship with God. God wants a relationship with you through Jesus Christ so he can lead and guide you into all truth. God, your maker, your manufacturer, knows who you are. He's got the very hairs on your head numbers. He knows the gifts he's given you and a personal relationship. Just think about that just for a second. A personal relationship with the God of heaven and earth who created you, who's not mad at you, but madly in love with you. Despite your shortcomings, in spite of the mistakes you've made, despite all the sin, all the stuff that we've blown it in life, God has sent Jesus to receive the punishment that was due us. And as we receive him as Lord, he wants this personal relationship with us. And that's what the whole New Testament is about. And that's why I want to connect with you every single morning in prayer and Proverbs so you can understand this relationship. That's what the New Covenant is about. And that is the most important key to your success in marriage, your success in health. Money won't get it. Money won't cure you of cancer, but your righteousness, your position with God can. Money can't heal you of a bad marriage. It won't. It doesn't matter how much money you have. That won't fix a bad situation in marriage or heal your kids or turn. It's relationship with God. So we established that over the last several weeks. We've covered so much material, but let's dig into this. Today I want to dig in a little bit deeper in understanding. We've already talked about that every human being comes to earth with gifts. You've been gifted. You're gifted differently than everyone else. There's nobody that can do that. There's no one on the earth that can do what you do like you do but you. You've been uniquely gifted. That's why we all have different fingerprints. And really, one of the greatest keys, and we talked about this last week, is understanding, recognizing your gifts, and then cultivating that with education, cultivating that with practice. It is the remedy for lazy. I really believe, because we're going to look at the scriptures today about diligent work and integrity, doing things right, all from the Proverbs. I'm going to delve into the Proverbs, and I know we're not on prayer and proverb in this session, but the book of Proverbs just gives so many keys to success in life. I've seen so many believers that struggle financially, that struggle in life, and life is really, really simple and easy when you do it God's way. So let's jump into the word. The Proverbs repeatedly teach on the importance of the and value of honest, diligent work. Have you ever heard any people? Have you ever heard anybody that just say, "Oh, I can't stand. I got to go to work today. I got like it's a burden." And I understand it because many people who aren't living, they're making. They're just trying to make a living or doing things they're not gifted to do that they don't love doing. And so then they hate it. But the Bible teaches it a different way, and we talked about that last week. But let's go into a little more specifics about once you discover what you're born to do, your gifts, and find the work that you love, the Proverbs gives us some real instruction that will show you how to live a great, blessed life, a prosperous life, and get promoted. In fact, let me say this. Even before I was doing this, I was a vice president in a bank. Listen, y'all, don't be impressed by that. I hated it, and they hated me. It was not what I was born to do. I ended up getting fired. Not for doing anything wrong, but my boss set me down. She was a senior vice president in the bank, and she said, Lee, I'm going to do you a favor today. I'm going to let you go. But she paid me 2 months afterwards for not even being there. But she said this to me, find out what you're born to do. You're a great young man. This is not what you're gifted to do. And that she did me the greatest favor of my life. And so we've talked about that. But let's go into the Bible. Turn over. I'm going to go from Proverbs chapter 6 all the way to Proverbs 31 and just pull some verses. We're going to go through it pretty quickly. But the Bible in the book of Proverbs, about every topic that you need in life, from health to wealth to work to children, discipline, marriage, everything can be sought out and found right there in the Proverbs. Let's look at what the Bible says about going to work. Let's take a look at this, because there's many believers that are slothful in their work and then still trying to figure out why they're broke, why they're struggling in life. Here we go. Proverbs chapter 6, beginning at verse 6. I'm going to go read through verse 11 in the New King James Bible. Yes. Look what the Bible says here. Solomon writing, he says, go to the ant, you sluggard. Consider her ways and be wise. Have you ever looked at ants, how they're busy working and building? Look at this, what it says, verse 7, which having no captain, no overseer or ruler, no boss, provides her supplies in the summer and gathers her food in the harvest. How long will you slumber, O sluggard? When will you rise from your sleep? A little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to sleep. So shall your poverty come on you like a prowler and your need like an armed man. Now, today is going to be very, very practical. But I find that many believers don't understand the real practicality and real simplicity of work, of life. And here he says, listen, be like an ant. Don't need somebody to tell you what to do. Be a self-initiating person who will get there. Listen, what the Bible is saying right here is the reason that you're broke is, it can be, and this is the number one reason that the Bible shows, is laziness. Just not going to work, not putting in what's necessary. Come on, somebody. I've seen people that show up late at work consistently, leave early. I used to even be one of them when I hated what I was doing. And so again, I think a lot, oftentimes that what we see as lazy is oftentimes mistaken for just doing the wrong thing. And that's why you need to get with your maker and with Jesus and understand what you love to do and then go do that. Praise the Lord. Y'all see that? Here, put that verse back up there just one more time for me, that last one. So shall your poverty come on you like a prowler, meaning it sneaks up on you, and your need like an armed man. This is all throughout the Proverbs, that passage right there. So poverty comes from not being diligent in work. Go to the next one. Go to Proverbs 10. I'm going to read verse 4 and 5, then 9 through 9 and 10, and then verse 26. Real practical. Watch this. He who has a slack hand becomes poor. There's a good answer right there. But the hand of the diligent does what? Makes rich. Being diligent over your gift, becoming the best at it will make you rich. Look at the next verse. He who gathers in the summer, verse 5, is a wise son. He who sleeps in the harvest is a son who causes shame. In other words, he's sleeping when he should be working. Come on, somebody. Amen. We've all experienced that and seen that to some extent. Go on to verse 9 and 10. Same proverb, Proverbs chapter 10. He who walks with integrity. Now, this is pretty important right here. Walks securely, but he who perverts his way will become known. The Bible over and over and over talks about working hard, but working with integrity, being honest. What does that mean? Showing up on time, not stealing time, not lying and cheating and running game. It means showing up, being diligent over what you're doing. And the Bible lets us know you're going to get promoted. Promotion is not hard. I am telling you, I started working as a kid. I've been working since I was 10 years old. My dad got us, me and my brother, paper routes when we were really young. And back in the 60s and 70s, the newspapers were delivered by little kids. And so we delivered them on, and we would collect, and we had our own money. I mean, we bought our musical instruments. Our parents made us buy stuff and be responsible and learn how to do things. But I'll never forget, the first job I got when I was in college was working at UPS. And I started out as unloading boxes. It was just a hard job. It was in trailers, very hard, and a lot of students, college kids there. Started working part-time. But you know what? I got promoted. I worked really, really hard. I learned these principles early on when I got saved. I was 18 years old and started understanding these things, hard work and being diligent. Do you know they promoted me to a shift operations supervisor? I was able to buy a house by the time I was 22 years old. 22 years old because I had made so much money just working hard and going to school. These principles will work if you will work them. Watch this. He who walks in his integrity. Yeah, verse 10. He who winks with the eye causes trouble, but a prating fool will fall. What is this talking about? This is talking about running game. You know, like being a trickster, running game. If you're in sales, lying about the product, that kind of stuff. So again, these passages you're going to see, I just want to show you. Honest, good, hard work, diligent, showing up on time, showing up consistently, doing your best while you're there will bring promotion. Go to the next one. Go to verse 26 in the same chapter. As vinegar to the teeth and smoke to the eyes, so is a lazy man to those who send him. The Bible says if you're lazy, you're going to become a pain in the butt to your boss. The bottom line is, you'll hear it over and over, if you're lazy, you're not going to be rewarded. In fact, you will be punished. Life will punish you. Life will not be rewarding. Let's go to the next one. Go over to Proverbs chapter 11, verse 1 and 3. Just looking at this is just practical information. This ain't nothing deep. Look at this. Dishonest scales are an abomination to the Lord, but a just weight is his delight. What is this talking about? This is talking about being honest in your work. Being honest. Have y'all ever been, you call in, say you started early, you start coughing like early in the week because you want to get off on a certain day? You know, you want the day. Why not just ask for the day off, but rather running game? Have you ever called in sick and then been at the mall and then run into somebody from work at the mall? Come on, somebody. This is what it's talking about. Just running game, lying about the sales, lying about what time you came in. No. Dishonest scales are an abomination. Do your work. Do it honestly. Go to verse 3. The integrity of the upright will guide them, but the perversity of the unfaithful will destroy them. Again, this is just talking about integrity, doing things right in your work. In every kind of career, there's always people who do dishonest things. You know, even in ministry, there's pastors who are doing corrupt things, but that doesn't make every pastor corrupt. There's lawyers that are doing things wrong. There's politicians that are doing things wrong. But that doesn't mean that you have to do things wrong. So you see here, do honest work. Jump over to Proverbs chapter 12. Proverbs chapter 12. Look at verse 9. I'm going to read verse 9 and 11 in the Good News translation. Look what it says here. It is better to be an ordinary person working for a living than to play the part of someone great but go hungry. This is talking about running game again. Acting like you're somebody that you're not. Acting like you're something big, but then he's saying just go to work. Just do the job. Y'all know what I'm talking about? Buying things you can't afford to impress people who don't care with money you don't have. It's pointless. He's saying just go to work and live where you are. You get it? Then to play the part of someone and go hungry, not really have anything. You get it? Overextending yourself. Verse 11, real practicality. Verse 11, Good News translation. A hardworking farmer has plenty to eat, but it is stupid to waste time on useless projects. When you read this passage in several translations, it talks about things like playing the lottery. Come on, somebody. I'm probably struck a chord there. But I know that there are people that play the lottery, wasting money week after week after week after week, throwing money away, when the Bible says, no, go to work, work hard, rather than wasting your money on fantasies, get rich quick schemes. There's going to be verses that even say that. Real practical. Jump to verse 22. I'm going to read 22, 24, and 27 in the New King James Version in Proverbs chapter 12. Look at this. Lying lips are an abomination to the Lord, but those who deal truthfully are his delight. So again, it's talking about dealings in work, telling the truth in sales, Don't sell a product, oversell it on things it can't do, right? But be truthful. Look at verse 24. The hand of the diligent will rule. They'll be the ones that get promoted. But the lazy man will be put to forced labor, doing work or standing out on the side of the road talking about, can you help me and give me some money and give me some food? Come on, somebody. Amen? In fact, yesterday I was somewhere at a store, and I drove by, and at the store I was at, it said they were hiring. And there was a person standing down at the street, at the edge of at the driveway, saying, we'll work for food. And of course, I wanted to tell them, but I wouldn't. They're hiring right here. Come on. That's got to be better than just standing out here asking for money. Come on, somebody. I know I made people mad with that one, but look at verse 27. The lazy man does not roast what he took in hunting, but diligence is a man's precious possession. The Bible is giving us a key here. In any work, labor, there is profit if you stay diligent at it. If you cultivate it, if you become the master of, have you met people that have become, they're the jack of all trades, but the master of none? The Bible over here, over and over says, no, become diligent at one thing. Learn to do something really, really good. Amen. Go to Proverbs chapter 13, verse 4 and 11. I'm going to read in the Amplified. Thank you back there. Y'all are doing a great job. Proverbs chapter 13, verse 4. The appetite of the sluggard, the lazy person, craves. They want a bunch, but gets nothing. But the appetite of the diligent is abundantly supplied. Isn't that good right there? The Bible says that you're the appetite of the sluggard. They want a whole bunch of stuff, but they're unwilling to go to work and do it and get it. I'm so grateful for my parents who started us working when we were little boys at age 10 and age 8. I remember the first purchase I made. This is probably in 1970. On my bicycle, I wanted a what they called back then a sissy bar, so you could pull willies and lean back on it. It was my first purchase. I bought it with my own money. Then I started buying pizza. This is when pizza started being delivered in the 70s. It was amazing. We had our own money. We could buy stuff. We could buy. My parents went and bought. We had a band, so we bought like this big equipment, like amps and guitars and stuff. But my parents paid for it, but they said, you're going to pay us back on a weekly payment plan, because we had jobs delivering papers. But it taught us responsibility. You get it? Watch this. Teach your children how to work, earn money. Verse 11 in Proverbs 13. Here we are. Yeah. Amplified version. Wealth not earned, but won in haste or unjustly from the production of things for vain or detrimental use. Such riches will dwindle away, but he who gathers little by little will increase his riches. This is the wisdom of God. The Bible says here that money that's won in haste or through vain or detrimental uses. This is talking about things, again, like lottery and gambling and things like that. It says, no, your money will dwindle away even if you win. But all you got to do is turn on cable and see that show, like I won the lottery and it changed my life. Some of them dead, some of them in jail, just a mess. And now, don't get me wrong. If you win the lottery, pay your tithe, praise his name, hallelujah. But the Bible says, don't lean on that. Lean on learning how to work and make a living and gather little by little. Spend less than you make. The key to success is very easy. Find the work you love. Do it diligently and spend less than you make. Let's go on. Go on to Proverbs chapter 14, verse 23. Thank y'all. New King James Version. In all labor there is profit. You say, Pastor, I'm going to stay on unemployment because I can't find the job that I like. There is labor, there in all labor there is profit. You don't have to like the job at first. Just work. Now, let me talk strong here, because I have talked to men before, and I'll say, hey, are you working? No. And then I'll say it the next month, are you working? No. Then I'll say it 6 months later, and they'll say, no. And a year later, there is absolutely no reason, unless you're handicapped or something like that, to be out of work, I think, for more than a week. Now, watch. Let me just tell you what I mean before you get offended. There's all types of temporary agencies. When we came to this city, we sold everything we had in Orlando, Florida, and came to this city, sold our house, sold our furniture, sold everything, and had a church, started church service. Immediately, since there was no money coming in, I got a job the next day at a temp agency. You get what I'm saying? Was I doing what I like to do? No, I just had to pay my bills, take care of my family, feed my kids. Come on, somebody. Pay my child support. All that stuff. You get it? You don't have to be deep. There, in all labor, there is profit. While I was working those jobs, there was one time years ago in my life that I worked three jobs at one time. Three jobs just to get on my feet. It was after a divorce and my wife left. Y'all heard me tell the stories when I was going to lose my house and lose everything. I got three jobs. Three jobs. Come on, somebody. In all labor, there is profit. But look at this. But idle chatter leads only to poverty. Just talk. You know, one of these days, I'm going to do this. One of these days, I've been talking. A friend of mine has been telling me he's going to get his real estate license, I know, for the last 2 decades. Stop talking to me about that and do it. Stop talking about getting the license for insurance and do it. Stop talking about starting that business or going back to school and just do it. Hallelujah. Are you mad yet? Are you uncomfortable yet? If not, let's just keep going. You will by the time we finish. Watch this. Proverbs chapter 15 and verse 19. Isn't the wisdom of God just good and practical? Watch this. Proverbs chapter 15, verse 19, it says, the way of the lazy man is like a hedge of thorns. You ever get stuck in thorns and hedges, get all scratched up? But the way of the upright is a highway. The lazy person, life gets hard for them, is what it's saying. It'll scar you up. It'll scratch you up. Isn't that good? But the way of the righteous is a highway. The righteous should be working. Come on, somebody. Turn over to Proverbs chapter 16, verse 26. Watch this. I love this passage. I'm reading it in the NIV. It says, the appetite of laborers works for them. Their hunger drives them on. I love this passage because the Bible is essentially saying, stay hungry. Stay hungry. Keep going after it. Keep going after something. Keep reaching for it. Your appetite, you should have an appetite to provide for your family. You should have an appetite to enjoy the good of all your labor. You should have an appetite to enjoy the greatest things that God makes available for us. And the way he does it is through our work. Through our work, God gives us work so that we can go out and work and provide for our families and give. And so we're going to see that as well. Amen? Your appetite. When I see people standing around and just going, oh, I'm so hungry. We'll work. No, your appetite should drive you to work. Come on, somebody. Not beg. It's quiet in this church, but of course nobody's here but us. Proverbs chapter 18 and verse 9 in the Amplified Bible. I remember this as a kid. We used to ask our parents, hey, Dad, we want this. He says, so? That's why you work. That's why you work. Come on, somebody. What a great lesson. Proverbs chapter 18 and verse 9 in the Amplified. Look at this one. He who is loose and slack in his work is brother to him who is a destroyer, and he who does not use his endeavors to heal himself is brother to him who commits suicide. Now, hear what this passage is saying, because this is the wisdom of God. The Bible says if you're slack in your work, you're like a person who doesn't use what God's given him to heal himself. God has given us an ability to provide for ourselves the things that we need and desire in life. So he gives us all this ability and giftings to produce income. We've all got it. And he's saying if you're slack and loose in your work, it's like being a brother to one who is a destroyer or one who commits suicide. You're killing yourself if you don't utilize your endeavors to bring in rewards for your labor. Do y'all get that? That is such a powerful passage to me. Turn over to Proverbs chapter 19. We're going to look at verse 1, then 15 and 24. Just real practical. We ain't going to get deep today. I'm just going to show you what the Bible says about work and being diligent over it. You can turn your whole life around. Watch this. Proverbs chapter 19, verse 1 says, better is the poor who walks in his integrity than one who is perverse in his lips and is a fool. So the Bible says it's better to be honest and not have a whole lot of money than to cheat and lie to get money. You get what I'm saying? Because that will land you in trouble, can land you in jail. Money that is gained, ill-gotten, cheating, lying, running game, stealing, is going to leave you. So he's saying, do it honestly. Do all your work honestly. Hey, if it didn't work out, just tell him, hey, I messed up. I messed that up. I blew it. Come on, somebody. We've all had some good days and some bad days. It's better to just say, you know what? I missed it. I messed that up, rather than lying about it or cheating on it. Praise the Lord. Look at verse 15, Proverbs 19. Laziness casts one into a deep sleep, and an idle person will suffer hunger. The Bible says in Thessalonians, if you don't work, you don't eat. And I always think about that when I drive my car out of Sam's or places where there's a lot of people standing around saying, give me money. The Bible says if you don't work, you're not supposed to eat. Of course you're hungry. You get it? An idle person will suffer hunger and broke and homelessness. Come on, somebody. And I know there are extenuating circumstances. There are some people that are really downtrodden, that have had some things occur to them. But what the Bible keeps saying over and over is, it's laziness. We've got to learn to work. Praise the Lord. Yes, I know there are some circumstances that don't fit into this scenario. But watch this. Verse 24, Proverbs 19, verse 24. A lazy man buries his hand in his bowl and will not as so much as bring it to his mouth again. He says it's too lazy to feed himself. Good God. Do y'all get the passages here? It gives you a whole different outlook. Gives you a whole different outlook on people who won't work. I've seen people that, oh, praise the Lord. Let me go on. Go to Proverbs chapter 20. I'm going to read these in the New Living Translation, verse 4, 7, and 13. New Living. Look at this one. Those too lazy to plow in the right season will have no food at the harvest. Once again, the number one thing the Bible keeps saying that causes people to be poor is laziness. Go to the next one for me. Verse 7. The godly walk with integrity. Blessed are their children who follow them. This is lovely right here. I love this. If you and I as parents do things right, it will show our children how to do things right, how to work hard, how to be honest. I'll never forget the day my brother and I, this is back in the 60s or the 70s, we were little boys sitting in the back of the car, and we'd go to the drive-in movie theater with our parents on Friday nights, back then when they had drive-in movie theaters. And we'd go, and I'll never forget, I was old enough to read the sign, and the sign said, children, and I don't remember what the age was, but it was a certain age that if they were younger than that, you could get in free. And I'll never forget, I leaned up to my dad, and I hit him on the shoulder, and I said, hey, Dad, look at that sign. It says if the kids are whatever age it is, under 8, the kids get in free. And I said, Dad, why don't you just tell them we're under 8, and we'll get in free. And he said, because that would be a lie, Lee. It shut me down. What it did was make me realize my dad's going to do things honestly. And that's the way to do it. Are you with me? Taught me right up front. I got more whoopings for being caught in a lie than anything else. Come on, a somebody. The godly walk in his integrity. Blessed are their children who follow. Thank you, Mom and Dad, for living a life of integrity. Go to the next one. Go to verse 13. If you love sleep, you will end in poverty. Keep your eyes open and there will be plenty to eat. I love this passage. Years ago when I was in college and started just really getting into verbs, into the Proverbs, a buddy of mine, Todd Williams, he runs a Fortune 500 company now, his own. He's the CEO. Went to Harvard and runs several companies, runs a prosperous company. But I remember we were in college at Ohio State University, and he had this verse right on his alarm. On his alarm, sitting right next to his alarm, it said, if you love sleep, you'll be broke. And I'll never forget how he always talked about this passage. He, of course, he's a very wealthy man right now, and probably because of this verse right here. Amen, amen. Go over in your Bible to the next chapter, Proverbs chapter 21. Proverbs 21. Almost every chapter talks about this. Almost every chapter in Proverbs will touch something in life very practically. That's why I want you to join with me, prayer and proverb every morning. But look at this one, Proverbs 21, verse 5 in NLT. Listen to this. Good planning and hard work lead to prosperity. There, you want prosperity? There you go. But hasty shortcuts lead to poverty, cutting corners, not doing the work properly. Come on, somebody. We've all been guilty of that. But the Bible says you live a life like that, it's going to lead you to poverty. Isn't that good news? Cheating in school, cheating your way, running game. Come on, somebody. Let's look at verse 25 and 26 in the Amplified. We're in Proverbs 21. Look at this one, 25 and 26. The desire of the slothful kills him, for his hands refuse to labor. He wants that house. He wants that car. He wants so much, but won't work for it. Hit the next verse. He covets greedily all the day long, but the uncompromisingly righteous gives and does not withhold. Keep that verse up there for me. This is so interesting right here, because the Bible talks about us being righteous. And the Bible, do you know that the Bible says for us as the righteous that we are to work so we have something to give? Work so that we have something to give. What is the whole principle here is that God has given us gifts so that we can go and work and have seed in our hand to give. Look at Ephesians chapter 4. I'm going to run out of the Proverbs just for a second. But the Bible says this in the New Testament. It says it all throughout the Old Testament as well. But let the thief steal no more, but rather let him be industrious, making an honest living with his own hands, so that he may be able to give to those in need. One of the first things that we have to help is our own family. Just be a blessing to our own. Come on, we can't have children without providing for them. We can't have a wife or, you get it, a family without working and providing for them. But here he says, he gives us another insight that we're working not to take all of our money and just put it on our bills, but to take a piece of it and sow it. Take a piece of your income and sow it into the kingdom of God as a kingdom believer, a kingdom citizen, and take another piece of it and save it. A piece of it and sow, a piece of it and save. Come on, somebody. Get in our financial peace class. I'll teach you all about that. Proverbs chapter 22. We're almost done. Proverbs chapter 22, verse 13 and 29. This is very practical, y'all, but that's what the Word of God is for. It's for practical application so we can live this life and the very blessed life that God has for us. Look at this, Proverbs 22 and verse 13, and I'm going to look at 29 in the Amplified. It says, the sluggard says, there's a lion outside. I shall be slain in the streets. What is that talking about? Making up excuses. Have y'all heard people who make up excuses why they can't do anything? Why they can't? Just excuse after excuse. Listen, kingdom citizens make it happen, not making excuses. Make it, just do it. I love that saying. Look at this. Go to the next one. Verse 29. Do you see a man diligent and skillful in his business or his work? One translation says, he will stand before kings and he will not stand before obscure men. What the Bible is saying here is if you become skillful and diligent at what you're doing, whatever it is, that you'll stand before kings. You'll be promoted to be serving great people, doing great things just because of the gift that you have, just because of the gift that you've been given. This is a major, major key right here. Be diligent. That means continue at it. Keep learning. Keep getting better and better for the rest of your life. Look over at Proverbs chapter 23, verse 4 and 5, New King James Version. Watch this. Oh, I love this instruction right here. Do not overwork to be rich because of your own understanding. Cease. Now, this is a powerful passage right here. Hit the next one for me. I think it's related. Watch this. Will you set your eyes on that which is not, talking about money, for riches certainly make themselves wings, they fly away like an eagle toward heaven. This is great instruction right here. The Bible says, don't put your eyes just on the reward of money. Now, this is a biblical principle. What the Bible is telling us here is, don't just work for money, work to serve that gift to people. The reward will be money. Okay, get what I'm saying right here. If you went to let's say you went to a hairdresser or a barber, and you went to the barber and the barber said, that's going to be $20. He didn't even put the clippers on your head yet, but he said, that's going to be $25. I need that money right now. I bet you'd never go to him again because he seems like he's more interested in your money than your hair. And so this is a principle that the Bible's saying. Don't put your eye on the money. Put your eye on serving the gift. Serve the gift the best you can. Serve that the best. And the byproduct, the result will be income. Don't put your eye on the money or it'll elude you. You get what I'm saying right there? This is a great truth. And this is why throughout the scriptures and in Ecclesiastes it talks about living your making versus just making a living. Making a living, you're just like, I got to go in that job and they better pay me my check, right? But when you're living your making, you're doing who you are, the gift, you're serving that gift out. You want to do that the best you can, and it will cause others to go, wow, they're really good at that. I want to buy that ticket. I want to go to that restaurant. Why? Because the service is so good. The food is so good. You get it? But if they're only interested in your money, trust me, they're not going to be interested in serving you your gift. That is a key that we've all got to understand. Amen. Amen. Look over in your Bible at the next one. Proverbs chapter 24, verse 30 through 34. Look at this one. Ooh, Solomon makes this observation. Watch what he says. I walk by the field of a lazy person, the vineyard of the one with no common sense. Look what he knows. And I saw that it was overgrown with nestles. It was covered with weeds, and its walls were broken down. He wasn't taking care of it, right? Then as I looked and thought about it, I learned this lesson. What did you learn, Solomon? A little extra sleep, a little more slumber, a little folding of the hands to rest. Then poverty will pounce on you like a bandit. Scarcity will attack you like an armed man. Now, don't get this wrong. All of us need rest. All of us are going to sleep a third of our life away. You get it. If you sleep 8 hours a day, and that's a lot, but if you do, doctors say you need that. Kids need more. But that's a third of your life. Every day of your life, out of 24 hours, a third of them should be resting and sleeping. So nothing's wrong with that. What the Bible's talking about is those other hours, the other 16. If you sleep those 16 too, you're going to be broke. Come on, somebody. Y'all see that? So we see that same kind of passage over and over. Look over at Proverbs chapter 26, verse 13 through 16, NLT. The lazy person, here we go again, claims there's a lion on the road. Yes, I'm sure there's a lion out there. You get what he's saying right here? Go to the next one. As a door swings forth, back and forth on its hinges, so the lazy person turns over in bed. The lazy people take food in their hand but don't even lift it to their mouth. Lazy people consider themselves smarter than seven wise counselors. Come on, somebody. Is this brilliant right here? Have y'all ever met broke philosophers? They know, I call them Dr. Doolittles. It's like they know everything but do nothing. Come on, somebody, Dr. Doolittle. You know so much. You're so brilliant, but you can't do anything. Come on, somebody. That's what the Bible is talking about here. They make up a bunch of excuses, but they're brilliant. They're a genius. Come on, somebody. We all know them. The Bible says that's going to make you broke. Jump over in your Bible to Proverbs 27. Two more passages here, and we're done. As workers who tend, oh, I love this. As workers who tend a fig tree are allowed to eat the fruit. Think about this. Workers who tend the fig tree are allowed to eat the fruit. So workers who protect their employer's interest will be rewarded. This is brilliant right here. The Bible is saying here that you and I, if we work for someone, should protect our employer's interest. We should watch out for their business. We should protect their business. Do you get what the Bible is doing here? If you show up at work early and they're concerned about that business, whatever it is. Let's say you work at McDonald's, but you're concerned not about wasting the product. You're concerned about giving the best service you possibly can. You walk in and you just work the fries, but I mean, you are working them fries. Come on, somebody. You are working them. You're making sure everything is done exactly like they want it done. You are working fast. Have you ever walked into a fast food place and they're like you have inconvenienced their day? Can I help you? Like you put them all out. But just think, if you had the right attitude, even there as a teenager or whatever, and you were working hard and you had a smile on your face, do you know what? I would fill out one of them comment cards and say, that person needs to be the manager. In fact, I saw this on the news. There was a young man, young black boy. He was working at Chick-fil-A, and he had such a great attitude. They ended up giving him a college scholarship just because so many customers were saying how great he did. I know that kid is going to do great things in life. And this is what the Bible is telling us. Watch out for your employer's interest. Watch out. Well, they don't pay me enough. I'm smarter than the boss. I should be in charge. Remember that last verse we read about how the lazy person knows more than everybody? Come on, somebody. Y'all get that one? Let's go to the next one. Look at verse, Proverbs 28, verse 6, and then we're going to 19 and 20. We're almost there. Better to be poor and honest than dishonest and rich. That makes it plain right there. Do things right. God has a way when you're honest and do things right to promote you. God can't promote you when you're, remember, because we're working as unto the Lord. We learned that last week. If you're honest and do things right, God will see to it that you're promoted. Praise the Lord. Verse 19, a hard worker has plenty of food, but a person who chases fantasies ends up in poverty. Now, that doesn't mean going after your dream. Going after your dream is great. What he's talking about is, who? It says it right here. A hardworking person has plenty of food, but chases fantasies, ends up in poverty. Put the next one up. Is that the? Yeah. The trustworthy person will get a rich reward, but a person who wants quick riches will get into trouble. I think in the message it says, one who chases after get-rich-quick schemes. That's what that's talking about. Have you ever met those? Met those people in different types of organizations, and they're going to make you rich really quick? The Bible says no. If you'll just be trustworthy, work with integrity, find your gift, work hard at it, be faithful, spend less money than you make, you're going to live a very prosperous life. Here's our last one, Proverbs chapter 31, about the virtuous woman. Go to verse 13. Women can work too. Of course, if you're a housewife and you're taking care of kids, raising babies, that's harder. Come on, somebody. I'd rather work three jobs than stay at home with babies. Come on, somebody. One of those jobs could be shoveling boo-boo, too. I don't care. Please don't make me stay at home with little babies. That's hard work for me. But that is hard work for a mom. But watch this. She, talking about the virtuous woman, seeks out wool and flax and works with willing hands to develop it. You get what I'm saying? She figures out stuff and works well with her hands. She is like the merchant ships loaded with foodstuffs. She brings her household food from a far country. She rises while it is yet still night. I mean, she gets up early in the morning and gets spiritual food for her family, her household, and assigns her maids their tasks. That lets you know that they're prosperous when they got maids and stuff. But the Bible is saying she isn't just laying around being lazy. Verse 16, she considers a new field before she buys or accepts it, expanding prudently and not courting neglect of her present duties by assuming other duties. With her savings of time and strength, she plants fruitful vines in her vineyard. What the Bible is saying, she doesn't let her outside responsibilities cause her to neglect her home responsibilities. You get it? She girds herself with strength, spirit. Look at the order. She girds herself with strength, spiritual, mental, and physical. You get it? Spiritual first, mental second, physical fitness for her God-given task, and makes her arms strong and firm. Yeah, she's got time to work out too. Look at that. Verse 18, she tastes and sees that her gain from work with and for God is good. Her lamp goes not out, but it burns on continually through the night of trouble, privation, or sorrow, warning away fear, doubt, and distrust. Next, she lays her hands to the spindle, and her hands hold the distaff. You see it? It's just saying she works. She opens her hand to the poor. She gives. She's benevolent. Yes, she reaches out her filled hands to the needy, whether in body, mind, or spirit. Notice what she does here. She gives out physically, mentally, and spiritually as well. The exact opposite order on that one. Verse 21, she fears not the snow for her family, for all her household are doubly clothed in scarlet. Scarlet represents royalty. Because one of the greatest things that happen in a household is a husband and wife work together to figure out, not necessarily on the same job, but they're working together for the same goals and providing for the family, making sure that everyone is well taken care of, that the bills are well paid. Verse 22, she makes herself coverlets, cushions, rugs, and of tapestry. Her clothing is of linen, pure and fine, and of purple. Her shoes have red on the bottom. That's what my wife likes. Come on, somebody. Such is that of which the clothing of the priest and the hallowed clothes or cloths of the temple were made. So she has fine clothing. Her husband is known in the city's gates when he sits among the elders of the city, of the land. Y'all get that? It's talking about a power couple working together. Her husband is, I read that one. Go to verse 24. She makes fine linen garments and leads others to buy them. She delivers to the merchants girdles or sashes that free one up for service. Strength and dignity are her clothing, and her position is strong and secure. You get it? You're getting this, that this is a woman who knows who she is. She's working well. She rejoices over the future, the latter day or time to come, knowing that she and her family are in readiness for it. She opens her mouth in skillful and godly wisdom. She's a woman on the verbs. And her tongue, on her tongue is the law of kindness, giving counsel and instruction. I love this. She looks well to how things go in her household. And the bread of idleness, gossip, discontent, and self-pity, she will not eat of that. Ooh, that's a good verse there. Mark that. Go to the next one. Is that the last one? I think that's the last one. I think we're finished. Yes. No, yes. That's it. Do y'all get this? The Bible tells us, for us as parents, husband and wife, as adults, we should work. And as we work, God, the Bible lets us know consistently, through hard work, diligence, integrity, doing things honestly, God will promote us. We will get promoted on our work. We'll have more and more and more, and God will bring us to a great life. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for this practical instruction, Lord. No, we're not going to fall out and go deep over this, but Lord, we want to know how to live the successful, blessed life. And we understand that you've gifted us, that we want to walk with you as our friend, knowing you as our personal Savior, you leading us and guiding us, and then you helping us and knowing the work, the gift that you've given us, the gifts, so that we can move towards them and do work that's pleasant, that's fun for us, that's rewarding, that we can truly be a blessing and get rewarded by it and sow our seed, save money, and do work that is a blessing to our community. Listen to me. You are a gift. What you've got, we need. There's a gift that you've been given that this generation needs. There's something that you got that we need. And there's something that I've got that you need. And hopefully I'm serving that to you right now. Listen, I want to thank you for joining me. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for everyone that's joined today and for the word today. If you're watching today and you've never made Jesus the Lord of your life, can I assure you, God's not mad at you. He's madly in love with you. He's so in love with you that he sent his son to die on your behalf for all your sin. And today, if you want Jesus as your Lord and Savior, just say this simple prayer. Say this after me. Say this: Father, in the name of Jesus, I believe that Jesus died and rose again from the dead just for me. You're my Lord, my Savior, my provider, my healer, my righteousness. Lord, you're my friend. Friend, if you said that simple prayer, you're born again right now, forever saved, forever forgiven, because you've accepted Jesus. Listen, we want to know if you've received Jesus. Let us know right there online. Listen, I look forward to connecting with you again, because God's got great things in store for you. I assure you, the rest of your life will be the best of your life as you live it and do it God's way. Listen, I can't wait to see you next time right here at Destiny Livestream, and I'm looking for you.